Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Q&A sessions with Meeta and Tosh. And we're really pleased to be joined by Neveen Gill today. Hi, Neveen Galal.
Hello. Good
nice to have you on board. Good to have you back. And you are our immigration law specialist. We need you. We need you today. We've got three hot topics, and we're actually going to start with immigration. Tosh, do you want to say that again?
I said it's very topical right now.
Very topical. We've picked three topics that we feel every business owner and people leader should be considering for their organization. The first one is immigration, the new UK rules and the impact on talent for your organization, what you need to be doing now and in the future.
Yeah.
Is IR35 rules. And the third is employees and the vaccine. What are your rights? What are their rights? So where should we start, guys?
Yes.
Well, one thing I want to let you know, Neveen, was there was quite a lot of inquiries about it even last week. So that was one of the reasons we wanted to set this up there, you know, in terms of putting some practical advice out there and making people understand, you know, what they need to do. Are they too late? Have they got time? All those different sorts of things. So we'll go into that in a minute. In just terms of the quick house rules, Amita. So chat box on the right. If you've got any questions as we go through, you know, we'll be dipping in and out. It's not just a Q&A session at the end. If you've got any questions for Neveen at all, please put them in the chat. Or if you're feeling shy for any reason, you know, contact us. We'll put you in touch with Naveen and she can answer your questions directly. But, you know, the idea is to make as much use as possible. And our promise is always to answer every single question in the chat box. So this will take about 30 to 40 minutes is our usual time frame, right?
Very much. Yeah. And we have you for the first 10 or 15 minutes. And we really appreciate you being on here today, Naveen. So you must be busy. Yeah.
I am. I'm extremely busy. Busy with lots of inquiries from people wanting to know a little bit more about the changes to worker routes in the UK following Brexit. So people generally knew this route to be called the Tier 2 worker. That's been replaced by the skilled worker route. And what that essentially means is you can come to the UK for the purpose of employment and have leave to remain for working in the UK, and it leads to settlement. Settlement is essentially the right to live in the UK free from restrictions. Some people also understand settlement to be indefinite leave to remain. Okay. And once you've had indefinite leave to remain, you can then apply for citizenship. And some people call that a passport, but what it means is you've converted into a British citizen, so you can have dual nationality. So it's really, really attractive to a lot of foreign employees to come to the UK, because they know at the end point, should they wish to settle in the UK, they can do that.
Okay. So I'm talking to employers every day about their people in their world. You know, we've got this deadline of April and we're talking about bringing talent in as well. So on one hand, we're talking about what to do with the people in their organization. There's things they can and can't do. There's questions they can't ask yet because it could be seen as discriminatory.
Yeah.
And at the other end, they're saying, well, listen, I can't hire the grads that are studying here anymore. That was my talent pipeline. So the range of challenges for organizations out there is really broad, isn't it?
It is, and it's not been made easy by the lack of guidance from the UK government. I'm known to speak out quite a bit about that, but they could make things a lot clearer, whether that's because of the pandemic, who knows. But one area that's particularly vague is this new graduate route, formerly known as the post-study worker route, which essentially enables UK students from abroad who come over here on a Tier 4 student visa to then continue working for a UK company. The UK government has said that it's going to come into place in the summer, but they haven't given any exact dates. And if you go onto the government website, again, it's not clear. So it's really difficult, even from a practitioner's point of view, to say, well, this is when you can make the application. And there's lots of students here really worried. And it's such a preferential route for these students because you don't need to be sponsored. It's a legitimate route on its own to be able to continue working after your degree, outside of the whole sponsorship license, skilled
work
route.
there, it was there before, and it's still there now. That option hasn't changed.
Yeah, so what we want to do is spread the word and basically say, look, there is this graduate route that's going to come into force this summer. Keep your eyes peeled, or speak to a practitioner like myself who literally spends days and days checking for updates, so that the moment we know when it comes into play, we're then there able to advise whoever calls us that this is the kickoff date. We know it's summer, it's going to be the graduates for this year, but the practicalities behind that is that these students are towards the end of their exams. They want to be able to concentrate on doing their exams and know where they stand in terms of work. Yeah. Unfortunately, they just don't have that certainty. You know, Priti Patel could get her housekeeping in order.
I wanted to ask two questions, two key questions from my client's sort of point of view and what's in my mind.
Sure.
Is number one is, so those that are already employing foreign employees, things have changed obviously from the 1st of January, what are the three key things they should be doing right now if they haven't done it, when should they get these things done by, is the first question. And the second question is, what is the nature of the market now? What's happening in your view in terms of what companies are doing now? Are they recruiting differently?
Yes.
Are they going abroad? Are they just going domestically? What's the vibe?
Great questions there, Tosh. So I'll deal with the first one first. So essentially, there's this panic about what should an employer be doing, that they're not erring on the wrong side of any kind of discrimination and things like that, treating people differently, offending staff, becoming too intrusive into their employees' personal lives. But the reality is this. You need, as an employer, to identify the immigration compliance within your organisation, regardless of whether or not you have a sponsorship licence.
Yes.
Where it's a formal duty. Sorry?
Is that essentially a checklist?
Ideally, or you have someone, if you're a large organisation, you have someone in HR that monitors who is subject to immigration control, because regardless of people's visa types, they are still subject to immigration control unless they have indefinite leave to remain or they've made an application under the EU settlement scheme. You are going to need to make sure from your own protection point that you are not liable for this employer's civil penalty fine, which we talked about before, which is £20,000 per employee. No one wants that. So behind the scenes, you need to, have an itinerary or a database, however way it's done, identifying all staff that's subject to immigration control, when their visas are due to expire, if they are from Europe, because that's a whole different category itself, and find out from them if they've made an application under the EU settlement scheme. And it can be just as simple as sending out a flyer across the whole firm saying, this is the guidance we've had from the Home Office, it's online, so it can't, that's not discriminatory at all, and just reminding them that the cut-off point is actually the 30th of June, and if they do nothing, then you know, you snooze, you lose. And no one wants to be in that position. So in a way, it's helpful to have an understanding perspective from the employer, but also the employee themselves, if they're from Europe, they're getting their applications done. And the EU settlement scheme is so simple. You do not need an immigration lawyer or anyone to do that for you. It's literally done by the app on the phone. And that should allay any concerns that person has on their ability to remain in the UK past the 30th of June, because that's the cutoff point.
Right.
So, So that's the European nationals. What if you have staff from other parts of the world? Again, it's identifying if they're here on perhaps a spouse visa or a skilled tier two visa. Is noting those deadlines and not leaving it until weeks before the person's visa expires. Everyone, when they come to make an application to extend their visa, they can do so 28 days before their visa expires. So as an employer, I would recommend that you earmark 2 months before the person's visa expires, and then just have a chat, because right to work checks are essential to cover the employer's back. not just at the beginning, but during. There's no point doing a right to work check at the beginning when you offer someone a job and then completely forget to monitor that person's visa conditions, and then find out that you're in breach because you've employed someone who may have forgotten to send their application off.
Naveen, you're so right. When people are hiring, when they're doing all the rights to work at the beginning, we're so thorough, we're all on it, everyone's ticking all the boxes, but having that internal system, and you can allocate that to, you know, your HR team or your head of operations or something, but the buck has to stop with some, because tell us about the penalties and the cost of the penalties if employers get it wrong.
I mean, they're excruciating.
Can I just jump on the back of what Misha just said, something more specific, which was just as a reminder, which you told us last time about that story where that client or somebody got stung in those circumstances, so with that penalty. Perhaps you could put it in that context when answering Misha's question.
Yeah, so it's absolutely excruciating because we're not talking about £500 or £1,000. We're talking about £20,000 per employee. It really is there to be seen as a deterrent and a warning that UK employers, we will come down hard on you if you employ someone who shouldn't be here or you fail to conduct your right to work checks adequately. The UK government have made it very clear from years gone by now that they want, you know, certain sectors to become pseudo immigration officers, be it landlords, employers. So they are essentially offloading the kind of immigration checks on us as employers and landlords and everything. And if you don't, you will be fined. And there is no explanation for it. If you're not doing those checks and balances from the outset, ongoing, then it's a world of pain.
Yeah. So border control and Priti Patel, once again.
Yeah, not a fan.
I know, we're not turning this into a political conversation. Yeah. I did actually put a question in the chat box asking our audience if they had immigration concerns for their organisation with a yes or no, but I've got no replies. Can you just let me know?
Yeah, sometimes people feel a little bit embarrassed to ask questions from... So they are welcome to email off record, and we can address those. But the key point being is it's really down to the employers to have robust systems in place to ensure that immigration is not overlooked. Yeah. It's so, so important. It's also very important to have any kind of immigration terms put in their employment contracts so that they're protected from an employment perspective as well. I don't think contracts previously, employment contracts, are going to do the job post-Brexit. I think there has to be a lot there to protect not just the employee but the employer in the event that dismissal has to take place. But obviously I don't know about that, so I'll leave that there.
There's been a comment here about the fact that actually there's a lot of UK organisations who have employees working from home, but their homes are now overseas. So how does that scenario what do they have to think about in that scenario?
As long as the job hasn't changed, they are still carrying out the same job role, but there's not been a material change in their job description, it should be okay. However, be mindful that if you are working for a sponsored licensed employer, that may need to be reflected as a change on the SMS system, and it could affect applications for settlement down the line. Because one thing that people need to be aware of, whenever you're making an application to settle in the UK, there are periods of absences that you mustn't exceed unless there are very, very exceptional circumstances. So so that's something that they need to be aware of. If they're out of the UK for a very long time and that could impact them on their settlement applications, they should seek some advice beforehand.
I've also seen situations where the people from the UK have gone abroad because it's got so bad in the UK, and so they've just gone abroad wherever they could come from, let's say. And then there are different implications for the employer because there might be a double tax issue. They're earning whilst they're abroad. So you might need to get some sort of, if you're facing that, anybody listening to that, you're going to need to get an accountant involved as well, presumably, because there might otherwise be an additional cost to an employer. So there's other factors other than employment.
And
We have a question around absences. So Rana is asking, what are the defined periods of absence?
So no more than 180 days in a 12-month period. So it's really important when I deal with settlement applications, and it tends to be a nightmare because most people just don't remember when they've been abroad in the last year, let alone going back to 5 years. No. I mean, you definitely wouldn't meet the criteria, Tosh. So what I would say to anybody is if you're on a visa route and your plan is to settle in the UK at some point prior to the 5 year period, keep an accurate record of every exit and entry date and the purpose of that journey. Yeah. Because you will need to refer to it when you make your settlement application. There is published guidance by the UK VI, which quite helpfully explains what continuous residence is. And continuous residence is generally broken if you spend more than 6 months of a year out of the UK. Because okay. You're not living in the UK if you're spending more than 6 months out.
It's a residence issue then, is it?
Yeah, because settlement and citizenship is essentially, you're saying that you want to live permanently, you consider yourself a UK resident. But if you're abusing the terms of your condition, you know, the conditions of your visa, and you've got a job, but then you're not turning up to work, things like that, you're just not going to meet the requirements of indefinite leave to remain. If you've had a poor punctuality attendance rate, that is also going to affect the settlement applications. And not a lot of people know this until the point that they're making the application. So it's really important that people seek advice before the point of application so that they're on the right path. There's lots of things to consider from an employment perspective, an employer and employee thing, which, if, like I say, if you have robust systems in place and you have an advisor on standby, it shouldn't be a problem. And there's lots of information on the Gov website regarding immigration rules, requirements and things.
Thank you, Naveen. Thank you so much. I'm looking at the time and I can't believe...
Sorry, Tosh, there was a second question you had and I didn't get a chance.
No. I can't believe how fast time goes here. Right. Just to sum it up, Sushila says that they do have challenges and they are really giving it a lot of serious attention right now. She's managing the organization's whole sponsorship license, and they've learned that they need to invest the time dealing with immigration matters in the organization. And ultimately, as you've said, plan well ahead. So
plan well ahead. And just I'll leave it as this is the key point I want you to express upon today, which is get your sponsor license applications done. You will need them.
You're a star. Naveen, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
As always, I'm sure we'll be inviting you back. And
I'd be happy to come back.
Wonderful. And
as you said before, we've been giving all of Naveen's details out. So, you know, you can contact us to get to her or contact her directly. Super helpful person. We have our guests, our people that want to help people. So, you know, do reach out if you need it.
Absolutely. Yeah. We've got this. And Naveen, it's great having you in our world and advising on this.
Pleasure.
Take care, Naveen.
Thank you. Bye.
Right, just while Naveen's saying goodbye, I'm going to literally move over to our poll. So thank you everyone who has partaken in the poll. Before we go on to our next topics, which are the vaccine and employer and employee rights and IR35, Tosh and I always like to get an understanding of what your quarter ahead is looking like. So we want to make sure we're focusing on the right things. And what we asked today is, what are you considering in terms of your staffing structure? Will you be considering redundancies? The furlough scheme's due to come to an end at the end of April. But as we know, Rashid may or may not extend it. And at the moment, we've got, God, it's really close. 45% of our attendees today say yes, they'll be considering it. And 55 say no. That's really telling, isn't it, Tosh?
But really, I mean, I'm surprised they know it's that high. That actually is quite a positive message.
Okay.
So either they've figured out...
I expected less.
So you know, if they're no and 55 is no, that means they're finding ways to get around it. It would be really good to understand what they're doing that the other 55% aren't. Is it to do with business not coming in? Is it to do with working arrangements or employees not perhaps getting on board with what needs to happen?
Yeah.
You know, or is it because maybe we think, you know what, Rishi's not going to just drop us in it. Yeah. He'll extend it again, but we can't think like that. We've got to prepare for the fact that it's probably going to end in April. And if something better comes along, we'll adapt like we have every other time it's happened like this.
Yeah. Well, thank you for your feedback on that, everyone. I think that we have to have a conversation around what to do when the end of furlough comes. So watch this space on that. But it actually leads us to our next topic, which I thought we could talk about employees and vaccinations, Tosh, because it's pretty obvious that as a country, especially London, as a, you know, an economic hub, everyone's pushing to get out of this. And I think part of that poll and the results of that poll is that organizations are saying we've got to get ourselves out of this. And the vaccine is really seen as a solution. But I'll tell you what was scary. You know, I love my stats. And this was a statistic that, you know, really, really, really brought it home, which was that this was an online magazine called HR Locker. It surveyed 750 businesses across Ireland and the UK. And it said that 40% of them would be willing to fire an employee who refused to get the COVID vaccine.
Wow.
Pretty high. And also, when further questioned for their opinion, it said that 70% of employers thought it was the responsibility of the employee to go ahead and make sure that happened. So there's a lot of there's going to be a lot of, you know, dust rising around this, a lot around discrimination, a lot around employment, a lot around hiring. I mean, where do we start?
I mean, you know, Mita, people are already asking me now about what do we do? Can we make it mandatory for employees to take the vaccine? So let's just put it in a little bit of context, right? The first thing is, obviously, the government are rolling it out now, free through the NHS. They're using the tapered system, so to speak, critically ill first, then it's going down by age and so forth, right? Yeah. So we know that. But we also know that rollout is going to take some time. It's not for the foreseeable future, at least, that there's going to be a private vaccine that's going to come out. So we don't know when that would happen. So we have to assume it's going to be the government scheme we're going out with their rollout for the time being. So can you force employees to take the vaccine is the question. Yeah. And the first thing I'm going to say is, you know, I love this word. It's a lawyer's dream word. Is it reasonable?
Yes. We need to have that word up everywhere.
What do you think? What are the circumstances that a lot of our clients, you know, whilst the natural instinct will say, well, hang on a minute, we've got a vaccine now, which says 95%, not 100%. And it doesn't include the new strain, by the way. So 95% chance you will not get this, Mita. So you come into work now. What objections do you like to arise?
The other side of it is if employees aren't getting it done and employers are letting them onto their premises, then what about their duty of care to protect their employees? You know, apparently 60% of employees currently feel unsafe going back into the office space. I think that's low.
I think that's the key issue, isn't it? That's the key issue to overcome those challenges. Yeah. How do you overcome objections? That's really what it's about. What is it that the employees are objecting to? Why are they saying no to the vaccine? What are the circumstances where they're saying, I'm not coming into work and I'm not getting a vaccine? Or any circumstances where they're not coming into work. It's the worry that is.
Well, what if they're coming into work, having said they're not getting a vaccine, and then putting other people at risk? I mean, that could also be something an employee brings up.
So it's the employer's obligation to create a safe place and working system, right? Safe place of work and working system work. If they are allowing employees to come in who are at risk and they haven't got the COVID secure measures in place as well, don't think the vaccine is a replacement for, you know, wearing a mask and social distancing. That doesn't stop. We're doing that as another layer. It's not a replacement. So if they will refuse to take it, then obviously that might be a different issue we're going to deal with in a second.
So that's really interesting because we've spoken about the COVID safe policies that organizations should have in place. They should put it on their intranet. They should email it out to employees. They should walk them through it. And I think where people have been working from home, and a lot of our focus, and this is what we're doing next week, is all around mental health and employers' responsibilities there. The kind of well-being and the safety has been around working from home and mental well-being and productivity and all the rest of it. But actually, you know, employers are considering April, May, June about getting people back into the office, and it's going to go back to what is your COVID policy. But now we've got to, do we need to have a vaccination policy as well? Should employers be thinking about that?
Absolutely, Amita. Not because it's mandatory again, but explaining why. Why? What is the process for the company? What is it that's now required, and why are these the rules moving forward? So what I want to address specifically is, what are the circumstances where an employee might say no? And then what does an employer? Because if they say yes, I'll get the vaccine and come in, well, it's not an issue.
Yeah.
So number one is, what if it's contrary to your religion? Number two might be, what if it is, you know, you don't want to come in either way, whether you get the vaccine or not get the vaccine, because it's only 95% protecting you, and you live with somebody who's critically ill. Or perhaps you're a pregnant employee and you can't take the vaccine, or you suffer from a disability and you can't take the vaccine. Well, those might be legitimate reasons in the circumstances where you won't be able to force them to come in. So what do you do? That's the question, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, that is a minefield, Josh, you know. It's just, there's so many scenarios. So let's start with, we have an employee who says, I know, you know, we're due back in the office around between April and June in that quarter, but just to let you know, boss, I'm not going to be taking the vaccine, but I'll be happy to come back in. What would happen in a scenario like that? What would an employer
There needs to be, obviously, an assessment of some sort done. We can't these days just let anybody come in, even if they're not showing symptoms. Presumably, they should get some sort of test to make sure that they're safe to come in, right?
They need to get tested. That would be the
I would have thought that would have been a requirement. Because the issue is this. What happens if it goes wrong? That's really the way to look at it. If it goes wrong, you want to be able to, and you get sued because somebody contracts it, or somebody suffers a personal injury, or somebody dies as a result of it. You need to be able to show, as an employer, you just need to be taking reasonable steps to prevent that from happening. Doesn't mean everything. It means taking reasonable precautions.
Yeah.
So if you just let people come in like that without there being any kind of testing, or maybe it's a scenario of doing what we're doing, you know, with the temperature guns and various other things and social distancing and so forth. But with the vaccine there, which is significantly increasing the possibility of not getting it, and having the measures in place because you're COVID secure. COVID secure, remember, there's about 14 different guidelines on the government website according to different types of organizations. So okay. It's all there, checklist of different things you can do to make it COVID secure,
yeah.
And then get them to get the vaccine. So if they say no, I would say you need to look at the checklist and yeah. See whether that's a risk you're prepared to take. Because if it goes wrong, you want to be able to say that you did everything that was reasonable in the circumstances, and we didn't have to make that person take the vaccine because it was reasonable for A, B, C, D, E. I don't know what that would be.
Okay. All right. That's good advice. It's a starting point, isn't it? And so an employer could just say, you need to work from home for now. And if they decide they want them in, making sure that they've got all the COVID secure measures in place.
Absolutely, Mita. Yeah. I think the number one starting was, why do we actually need them in the office? I appreciate it's better. It's always going to be better. It's like you and me meeting up, right? We can go for a meal together and face to face, and it's going to be a real different thing than perhaps doing it over Zoom or whatever platform we're using. There's going to be different, but do we need it?
So I've got a question from Sarah asking, are we allowed to send a generic email asking our employees what their intentions are in respect of taking the vaccine? That's a good question.
Absolutely you can, Sarah. There's no reason at all. And obviously their responses will then determine what action you do or don't take. Remember, it's that lawyer's word, that dream word, reasonable, isn't it? What is this objection and how do we overcome it?
I think that's really interesting, actually, Sarah, because, you know, throughout the last 10, 11 months, a lot of organisations I'm speaking to are continually doing straw polls, checking the temperature of the room polls, check-in polls, all sorts of polls around how people are doing, where they stand on certain things, and helps you to kind of guide and create the plan out of this challenging time. So I definitely think a starting point, and what great advice, let's use the poll in this way. Let's make it anonymous. So we start with just the temperature of the room. If that comes back with 100%, yes, I'm planning on taking it, then you kind of know all is well for now. And then you can start breaking it down into more specific if there's more no's in there, you know.
I think Sarah's approach is just a very grown up, sensible way of doing it.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Open some dialogue.
Yeah.
And as I say, we'll give you the information to then make some choices about what you're going to do about the ones that aren't going to do it and find out why.
Yeah.
So maybe you should ask their intentions. And maybe if they say no, you should ask, you know, why would that be? Then you're very clear on you.
Yeah. And Belinda's saying in that scenario, could people say that they prefer not to say? Could that be an option? Yes, no, prefer not to say, Tosh.
Yeah, that's fine. It's a little bit like somebody suffering from ill health, and they're not coming into work because of ill health, and they've got a doctor's note. And then we write to the employee and we say, look, we want to find out from the doctor what we can do to get you back to work. And the employee says no. Well, then you have to make a decision based on the information you have, which is nothing. They're just not coming in because they're ill. We have no idea when they'll be able to come back. And then you can go down a legitimate, fair dismissal process. So if they say no, then there's going to be other choices you'll make.
Yeah, I think, Belinda, for the purpose of this survey or email or getting the temperature of the room, it's probably better to put a yes or no. Doesn't mean people will necessarily do what they say they're going to do, but you get a feel, I think, for where people stand.
You know, your questions are not discriminatory, or don't be afraid to ask
them. I think that's what we're trying to work out, isn't it? Like, are we allowed to ask this?
Linda and Sarah are absolutely on the right path. You know, they're asking legitimate questions to help the business to make decisions actually in the interest of employees and the business. That's it.
Yeah. Maybe there could be a don't know, because there may be some people that haven't decided yet. They're still kind of umming and ahhing and waiting for, you know, the results and outcomes of those that have got the vaccine and whether there are any challenges.
I think, Neeta, it's coming to a head, isn't it? The I don't know will come to a head when the employer says, I need you to come into work. Because if they didn't need them to come into work, I'm presuming they're going to let them carry on working from home. It's not going to be an issue. The issue is if they can't work from home or they need them to come into the office.
Yeah. Well, you know, when I'm advising clients on the hiring process and looking at CVs of employees, potential employees, I was talking about the fact that some people have started to put on there, I'm vaccinated. I know it's only a small cohort of the total working population, but already people are putting onto their CVs, can an employer choose somebody who says they're vaccinated over somebody they're not, who says they're not, or doesn't say anything? Does that become a discrimination issue? There's going to be so many issues here, aren't there, Tosh?
I think there are. Absolutely there are. I don't think that will necessarily be an issue, because employers can make decisions based on what they feel is the right thing in the circumstances. So it won't, you know, if they're saying I'm not taking the vaccination and it's because of a disability and they know that, well, then it comes down to employers looking at reasonable adjustments and all the other things you would normally look at to get that person
back to protected characteristics, and only then is it discriminatory. Okay. So Shelley asks a question. Can we ask visiting outside contractors if they have had the vaccine? And can we ask outside contractors to take tests before visiting site?
Certainly you can ask them. The question, no problem at all, Shelley's answer is the first thing. The issue is if they say, well, we're not doing that.
Or we don't want to say. Yeah,
correct. What are you going to do? Either you're not going to allow them in, or you've got other measures in place, COVID secure measures in place. Yeah. That means you think, okay, that's fine. You know, we've got the temperature gun, we've got the distancing, we've got the masks on, and that's sufficient for our purposes.
Yeah. Wow. If anything, there's more questions rather than answers. But no, it's good actually, because it, as you say, it's about being reasonable. What I really pick up from this is that you can absolutely ask every question around vaccinations and around tests. You can make it a stipulation that people are vaccinated. You can make it a stipulation that people get tested. They can choose to say no, and then it's whether what you decide your policy is on those that say no. And there's no chance of that coming back on a discriminatory case.
This is the way I would advise any. Absolutely right, Amita. Well, this is the way I would advise anybody, is to take a balcony view on the situation. Don't get lost with the wood for the trees. What I mean by that is, if you have to explain yourself to a judge about what you did and why, can you reasonably do it? If the answer's yes, tick. If the answer's I don't know, then you need to speak to us about how we can make sure that it's all ticks.
Yeah.
If the answer's no, I can't do it, then you definitely need to speak to us. So we can just talk you through what you can do and make sure that you're protected. I appreciate I'm speaking about it from a legal point of view, so avoiding your legal liabilities. You know, the moral obligations are a whole different set of discussions, which will probably be a whole webinar and more. But that's the way I would look at it.
But legally, an employer can put in reasonable measures to say, we will not bring people in who aren't vaccinated. We will not allow contractors on site who are not vaccinated. And if they're not vaccinated, then the other alternative is they get a test. If they say no to the test, then they're not allowed in. The name's not down, they're not allowed in.
That phrase. I am totally right.
Good.
You know, Meet, if they do that, what else, you know, you could go to a judge and say, what else do you want us to do?
Yeah.
We've
got to protect our people, and we've got to protect the business and the organisation to push forward. And that's what we're doing. So that's good to know, Tosh. Thank you. It's I think we're going to be revisiting this topic and having a whole webinar just
most definitely. You know, we're still rolling out, right? We're not even there with it being available totally to the majority of the public yet.
Well, hopefully that gives everyone some points to take away, actions to put in place with emails and surveys, and watch this space. Let's talk more. Right, we've got one more topic to cover, and we've got about 5 minutes, and really, IR35, Josh, could, again, you know, merit a whole webinar session on its own. So of all the three topics that, you know, we've looked at today, for me, IR35 has been, I mean, it's been around forever, hasn't it? This penny dropping about IR35 rules, it's been constantly dangled in front of us, but finally, it's happening in April, is that right? What date is it finally coming into place?
So the new rules about off-payroll working in the private sector, so for contractors, is going to kick in on the 6th of April this year. In case anybody isn't clear on what exactly IR35 means, is it relates to a contractor's tax status. So if they are if they fall within the IR35 rules, they should be taxed like an employee, which could be at 40%, for example. If they're not classed as being like an employee in the way they operate, then their tax will be 20% or 11%, depending on however they've set up their tax affairs, right?
Yeah.
So you can imagine the system before MISA was, guess who had to assess whether the contractors fell within IR35?
The contractor.
Yeah, and guess what? They said we don't fall within it.
Right, so they want to pay less tax.
Cash as a result of contractors assessing it themselves.
Yeah.
So the difference now is, and just so we're clear, it's like me having one of my employees set up a company and then they're invoicing me, but actually they're doing the same work for me as if they're the employee. Nothing's changed.
No,
What
I used to call badges of trade way back when I became an accountant 20-odd years ago, it's a similar tick list, isn't it? But the onus now falls on the employer. It's the employer's responsibility. But one of the challenges is that a lot of contractors are saying the employers aren't doing the assessment. I mean, what would a contractor do and what would an employer do in that situation if they
The liability for not carrying out the assessment correctly, and ultimately that will be an HMRC scenario that will have to determine that.
Yeah.
If the employer, and this will particularly affect large organisations, I'll go through who's affected by it anyway, liability falls on the employer. They would end up having to pay the tax.
Yeah.
And there'd also be penalties involved as well. I don't know the details of those penalties yet. So those will be coming out if they're not out quite recently, but there's penalties as well as the full tax liability. So what's going to happen is employers, I think, are going to be very cautious about it. They don't want to be subject to those penalties. And what that means that the contractor is going to either have to play ball or go and find another client. It's as simple as that. They don't get, just because their tax status is deemed to be the same as the employee, that they don't get any other rights with it. They don't get the holiday rights or sickness benefits or anything else. Yeah. It's just purely a view on the tax. It's aimed at trying to stop the tax avoidance, which is what's been happening for forever.
Okay. Well, listen, we've got a couple of questions built around the same topic, which is IR35 only for UK contractors? Does it apply to consultants who might be based in Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland?
So I actually don't know the answer to that question, Helen, only because the area of law that my remit covers is England and Wales. But you know who would know that, Helen, would definitely be your accountant. Speak to your own accountant, they will definitely be able to confirm whether those rules will apply or not apply. Yeah. And do we know what makes them look like an employee or not? Should I go through that very quickly?
Yeah, we've got 2 minutes.
Okay, I'll do it in one. So the first thing is what makes somebody look like an employee? So the first thing is personal service. So there's no substitution. Because, you know, if it's an employee, if they don't turn up to work, they can't get their mother, their brother or their mate to come in. It's got to be them or nobody. Whereas if it's a contractor, so for like myself, for example, if you become a client of mine and I'm not available, one of my other staff will be just pick it up and just take my place. Yeah. So personal service is the first thing. Second thing is control. So for an employee status, you control what they do, when they do, how they do it. If it's a self-employed person or a genuinely independent person, they might control when you do it, but how you do it or what you do, not necessarily.
Yeah.
And the third thing is mutuality of obligation. I've got that means as an employee and an employer scenario, I've got an obligation to give my employees work and they've got an obligation to take it. Whereas self-employed contractor, they can say, well, I'm not doing that.
Yeah.
Or I'm not doing that then, or whatever the circumstances. If those three things are missing, or one of those three things are missing, well, then there's an argument you won't fall within IR35 rules. Obviously, the companies that have lots of different clients, and this is one of their clients, they're going to be able to clearly show they don't fall within the IR35 rules. But so effectively,
I was just going to say, as an employer, I would recommend you err on the side of caution if there is uncertainty, because Sarah has said that she applies the CSU test, but the result was uncertain, and that's an issue. Is there another source of assessment? What I would say is you've got. Is there another source of assessment first of all, Tosh, or is that it?
No, there's a long checklist of different things which you can find from the HMRC government website.
Yeah. But
essentially, those are the three first irreducible minimum, is what us lawyers refer to it as, for it to apply. But you know, effectively, if it looks like a duck and it quacks like a duck, it's a duck. Doesn't matter whether you put a company in the middle of it or put anything else in the way. So they're going to look at the way that they operate. But there's just very quickly, who does it apply to? It's going to be medium and large size firms in the private sector. And they have to meet three conditions, okay? The first one is their annual turnover has to be at least 10.2 million. The second condition is that their balance sheet is more than 5.1 billion. And the third condition, both are M's, not B. And the third one is that they have at least 50 employees.
50.
So if any of those three are not met, IR35 rules are not going to apply at the moment, not from the 6th of April. That might change later on, obviously.
Okay. We've got time for one more question. So Sam is asking, what if you already have a UK contractor on your book that has signed a contract for services and it ends in December 2021? Would you still have to re-register them?
From the 6th of April, Sam, yes. You have to now, you're obligated to carry out the assessment. Think about it. Imagine if I give one of my employees, tell them to set up a company. And then it goes over the 6th of April deadline. Well, it's still a scam or a sham, whatever you want to call it. Yeah. So I'm assuming, Sam, in your circumstances, you would already know whether they're genuine or not, because they're going to be providing their services to other companies or other clients and so forth. I thought it was two of those. No, it's three. It's those three conditions. 10.2 million annual turnover, 5.1 in their balance sheet, and 50 employees or more.
Well, on that note, I feel like we've just scratched the surface. So I think what we need to say is that watch this space, and we will be coming back to you with more IR35 insights and answering your questions in the coming weeks. Thank you, everyone, for attending. Thank you for your involvement. And remember, if you have more questions, Tosh and I are available outside of this session. We're here to help. We want to partner everyone on this really challenging journey with so many different scenarios going on out there. So We've got the answers together. Let's connect and get our solutions.
And then one last thing I want to leave you all with is please connect with us on LinkedIn. Mita and I, independently of each other as well, just send us so much free stuff that it's just putting some good and some helpfulness to the community, to the business community. So look, just, you know, if you don't like it, you can, you know, unsubscribe or knock us off or whatever it is. But I think you'll generally find some really helpful stuff. Plus, we will pick up the phone if you call us.
Yeah.
You know, Don't be fearful to reach out.
No, absolutely. I'm even getting WhatsApp sometimes and I love it. Easily accessible and easily answerable. So thank you all. We'll see you again 11 a.m. next Thursday. Take care.
See you next week.
Bye-bye.